Another useful application of these small, compact and cheap devices is home monitoring. And one example of home monitoring is retinal disease. And we can identify a number of these. One is age-related macular degeneration, and the other is diabetic retinopathy. These are two very large causes of blindness. 40 million cases in the US and Europe alone, and doubling by next year. I can't remember what year that figure came from, but these are really, really big problems. And I suppose you don't really notice how big an issue blindness is until you have to deal with it. We take our eyesight for granted. Just the fact that I've just started using glasses, I find extremely inconvenient, right? I mean, I can see reasonably well. I can read that and so on, but if I want to read a newspaper or something, I usually need to have glasses, and that's very annoying if you don't have them. I can't imagine what it's like for somebody who actually can't see where they're going. So it does make life very, very difficult, and of course it has a knock-on burden on society. Somebody who's blind needs an awful lot more help and is not going to be as financially productive or as helpful for their family as a person who has good eyesight. So if we can identify these things and fix them early, that's really important. So one of the things that we have done in this vein is to work towards developing some goggles, which basically will look like some sunglasses there, which shine light into your eye and work out the axial length, the length between between the cornea and the retina. And if that's changing suddenly, then you need to get a particular type of injection. You need to get that really quickly, reasonably quickly, not 6 months later, in order to arrest that development. Okay. And of course, you don't want to have unnecessary visits to your clinicians. One of the big problems with medicine these days is that clinicians don't actually have enough time to see the patients that they have. Typically, they're spending 10 minutes talking to a patient and making a life or death decision in that time, right? And the next patient is waiting outside the door to come in. So you want to reduce these unnecessary visits. If you know that there is not a significant change, then the person doesn't have to come in and be assessed. Okay, so the idea is that outcomes should improve from that. Okay, so how do we do this kind of thing? Well, we do it using optical coherence tomography, and we've been working on this very low-cost version of optical coherence tomography. I'll tell you a little about how that works in a moment, but it's a very small device that's actually more or less the physical size of it, a sort of matchbox size of device at this point in time. We want to make it smaller than that again, but it is able to do many of the things that very expensive and larger OCT systems can do, including looking at your fingerprint and the fingerprint below the surface, and of course there are applications in engineering and other things. We do have an interest in glucose tracking. That has been, I suppose, the greatest failure in the area of photomedicine of our times, right? The fact that we have not been able to develop a non-invasive, light-based glucose sensor. It sounds like a problem we should be able to solve. There's been at least 6 billion euros spent on it. More than 100 companies have said, we have a glucose sensor, this works. And sure, it follows glucose over time, but you put it on a different place the following day and it's slightly different. Right? The regulatory authorities in Europe and the United States have expressly said that they will not allow us to put these things on the market and for people to inject themselves with insulin unless they are accurate within a particular band. We know exactly what that is, but we have just never been able to achieve that level of accuracy. Right? And there's new ones coming out every month, right? New versions of this sort of thing. But they all fall down that hurdle of reproducibility and accuracy. Really critical things in any kind of imaging or measurement science. We have to be able to reproduce the measurement that we are making. We have to be able to know that it's going to be accurate, especially in those life or death situations where you inject insulin. Okay. So hopefully somebody will solve it. It would be great if somebody in this room could come up with a nice idea how to solve that. OCT seems to be the closest we've got so far. This, we can see small changes in the reflectivity of the surfaces when we have changes in glucose concentration, but it just hasn't been reproducible enough to date. So what is this OCT? Well, we have a light source, usually a superluminescent diode, which goes through an optical fiber, and these are basically, this is called a splitter, but basically it's two optical fibers. You twist them together and you let them melt, and you can get 90% of the light to go that way and 10% of the light to go this way, or whatever portion you want to get. That's what we use in this particular case. We've got light going to a mirror over here, which we call the reference arm, and then we have light that we put into the skin or into the brain or whatever tissue you're looking at here, and this basically just scans it over and back across the surface of the tissue. That light comes back to a detector, which we then use to get the measurement of reflectivity from the surface. And here's a 3D section of my skin from my fingertip, and you can see that we have these spiral looking things, which are sweat ducts coming to the surface. You have ridges here, which are the fingerprint at the surface, and you can see these other structures. And in order to get these measurements, we put in the light, we move the reference arm in and out. That gets us measurements from deeper and less deep inside the tissue, and we measure that reflectivity. And we produce an image which looks a bit like an ultrasound image. It's much higher resolution, but it doesn't go as deep. Why are we doing this? We want to have techniques that address problems for the other 6.5 billion people in the world, and also for home monitoring, right? Nobody's going to spend 120,000 or even 50,000 on a device for home monitoring. They might spend €1,000 on it. The current machines are basically those kinds of prices. Okay. And the idea is to have a very small device that can be integrated into a mobile phone, or at least attached to a mobile phone in the end. And we base this idea, and the idea that it can be really cheap, i.e. the parts can cost as little as $10, on the idea that you have already on the market something very similar, which is a DVD pickup drive. It has all of the same components. It has a moving voice coil with a lens. It's got a laser. We actually have a superluminescent diode, which is a very similar thing. That has a grating and a beam splitter, a lens and a detector. Our device is almost the same, superluminescent diode, beam splitter, lens. We're looking at a sample up here, not a CD or a DVD. And we have a voice coil which allows the light to go deeper and less deep into the tissue. And we have a detector over there. So this is very, very similar to something that currently costs $5, and we figure should be the same as the one on the surface. Okay, so that's what these sort of things look like. Maybe I'll just skip over this a little bit. It's essentially the same idea. I suppose the thing that makes this low cost is that we can have a very small movement of the mirror here, and for anybody with a physics background, we have a partial mirror here which leaves a small amount of light through there, and we get this small scan, and if the light passes twice through that partial mirror, you get a second scan, and if it goes three times through that, you get this scan. And so we're going deeper and deeper into the tissue, but with a very small movement of the mirror, and that's quite important because it takes time for the mirror to move, and we can do that much more quickly if it's a very small movement. And so this makes the device very small, very cheap, and very compact. So here is an application. I said that it would be nice to have a dermoscope where you could see the depth of the feature that you want to look at. And in fact, one of my students made this dermoscope, and you can just point to some area and see what the structure looks like underneath the surface. So you have some highly reflecting thing, half a millimeter below the surface. In that case, that's 0.3. That's where that location is, and you can see if that was a melanoma, you could see, is that structure very deep or not very deep in the tissue? Okay, so this is a closer look at my finger and the sweat ducts. You can see along there, the ridges along the surface. You see that the sweat ducts, those, they look like dots when we slice across here. We're looking at a slice now, out of my finger in that direction. You see the fingerprint, and you see the sweat ducts are lined up along that fingerprint. And below the surface, about a third of a millimeter below the surface, we have the subsurface fingerprint. These are actually the primary ridges. They're actually separate from what you see on the surface, but they follow exactly the same pattern. And so if that isn't exactly the same as the one on the surface, then the person who presents that fingerprint is not the person that they're claiming to be, which is really important. When people use it to get access to your phone, to your bank account, to border security, I don't know if any of you have used the automated border security now, where you don't actually speak to a person, you put your fingerprint and you show your passport to a machine. But this sort of thing becomes very, very important in that case. And it's hard to see on this screen, but those little dots are the little capillary loops that are coming up to the surface. Sorry, I've just broken your pointer. To supply the ridges of the fingerprint that are there close to the surface. So you must have blood supply within 60 microns of every living cell. Okay, so those, when we cut across them, you see two dots or a regular loop, and they are following the fingerprint. And you also see that, in fact, these horizontal plexus, which is just below the papillary loops, is following that fingerprint as well. And if those things are not following each other, then it's not the fingerprint that is being shown at the surface, which is presumably being used to show a phone or the border scanner or so on. How do we know what those things look like in reality? Well, this is what they look like, not exactly in life, but in any case, you see over here the ridges that make up the fingerprint, and here are the little capillary loops in there. Now, I told you that you shouldn't be able to see this because this is resolution is much better than the depth divided by 200, but actually this picture over here is where those blood vessels have been filled with a special ink and the finger has been corroded away entirely, right? So you wouldn't do this with a living person, right? You're not going to get somebody volunteer to do that, but this is done with a cadaver, presumably a very fresh cadaver like that. But you can see the details. Maybe those blood vessels should not be quite as contorted as they look there, but maybe Professor Barry can comment on that later. One very interesting thing to note, though, is that you do not, at least in human soft tissues, and I mean not bones, not teeth, but most other tissues, you do not typically have living cells more than about 65 microns away from a patent blood supply. We know that at least in mice that is the case because of this paper here, which shows that the density of the number of these things that exists falls off very sharply at about 65 microns, except in the case of tumors, where you can have cells that are a bit further away. But I suspect that those cells are not surviving very long so far away from the blood supply. So why would you think that? Okay, so what is the limiting factor? It's going to be oxygen supply, yeah. And the diffusion of oxygen occurs over a distance of roughly 65 microns, and most of those tissues and does not go beyond that. Right, so, So how do we get these images of where the blood is and where the blood is not? Well, the simplest technique, one that we developed, is where you have the area in here was showing things changing over time, and the rest of it was static over time, and that is static tissue, and this is where there is some flowing fluid with some scatterers that mimic blood cells. And what is important to notice is that if you compare this image with one a very short time later, a few milliseconds later, the static part will not have changed, the moving part will have changed, and if you do what is known as cross-correlation between the two, you'll have a low correlation where the thing has moved, you'll have a high correlation where the thing hasn't moved, and so, hey presto, you have a way to say this is static tissue that is moving blood. Does that make sense? So you're just comparing one image with one some short time later. The stuff that has moved will have a low correlation because it's just changed. The stuff that hasn't moved is static skin or brain, whatever it is. And that's how you can produce these images of where the blood vessels are, where that horizontal plexus is, and so on. And of course, this turns out to be a very highly secure way of doing biometrics, of checking your fingerprint. And in fact, you know, there are many ways of doing identification. People talk about iris scanning and face scanning and so on. A big advantage the fingerprint has is there is a massive database for everybody who has a passport, for example, right? That's already there. All we need to do is check that what is underneath the surface is really what is being presented to the scanner. Right? So if somebody's trying to fake, they can print a 3D image of your fingerprint from the glass that you just used, right? Not that hard for a two-dimensional image, and present that to the scanner and go through. If they're really nasty and they're into human trafficking or something like that, they might chop your finger off and present that to the scanner, okay? But this requires flowing blood in tiny blood vessels, which is extraordinarily difficult to do. If you talk to anybody who does microfluidics, getting body fluids or any kind of biofluid to flow through one glass capillary that's 100 microns in diameter and keep that operational is actually quite difficult. These are hundreds of vessels that are 20 microns, and they have to go in loops, and they have to follow the pattern of the fingerprint. So really, I would say, I rarely say anything's impossible, but that's really, really difficult, I would say. Okay? So, for those who want to know the details, when we do the imaging, we have an area that's flowing. This is just a model to show with some blue tack, basically. Experimentalist favorite friend, glass capillary tube, something flowing there that has some scapulars in it, and we pick up this flow region just by comparing the static region, which is the same in the next image, and the flow region, which is different in the next image. So you have low correlation, which we color bright, and high correlation, which we just color dark, and we're able to pick that out. And for people who are really pernickety and want to know a lot of detail, we actually do this with 3 pixels by 3 pixels from the first frame, the same from the second frame, and we just scan along and we come up with 1 pixel in the final image from each of those 3 by 3 kerns. Okay. And then we compare those 3D volumes. We create a mask which gets rid of the noisy bit, which is deeper in the tissue, and so we end up with a nice clean image of just where the flow is, and we superimpose that back on top of the OCT image, which looks like this. So typically OCT shows you a B scan just like ultrasound does, except that the depth is maybe a milliliter and the resolution is 10 microns. In ultrasound, you are looking a few centimeters into the tissue, and the resolution is maybe a millimeter or a little bit better than that.
Yeah. Okay. I have a question.
Yeah.
Hypothetically, if it wasn't blood, but would be a fluid that is like perfectly homogeneous, would you then realize that it's cyanide?
No, it would have to be scattering in some way. So if by homogeneous you mean there's no change in the refractive index, there's no reflection of the light that's different, then we wouldn't see anything. And in fact, it's a very good question, because it turns out we were trying for years to figure out how we would image the lymph vessels. And the lymph vessels are basically like that. They do have a few white cells in them, maybe more in disease and so on, but actually they're a clear fluid, and you can't. Can't see them, but it turns out that that's the answer to the question. Where you have a very, very, very low signal, then that's a lymph vessel, right? Just like in ultrasound, where you have a void, is where the water is. There is no reflection of the sound because there is no change in the mechanical property in that region. And in fact, it's only 4 or 5 years now since we discovered lymph vessels in the brain, what are now called lymph vessels, right? Because they're related to the glial cells somehow. Professor Barrio can explain that, but basically, yeah. And the reason we didn't know they were there is probably because we can't see them. There's no contrast, right? Or very little contrast. So yeah, very good question. All right, so from that, the important thing is we can see what those vessels look like at different depths in the tissue. We can look at it in 3D, turn it around, and we can see which ones are the loops that are really the nutritional vessels. We can see the horizontal plexus, and we can see an AV shunts and that sort of thing within the tissue, and do some much more interesting physiology with that. Okay, and of course, that could solve the problem that we have, very modern problem, with access to bank accounts, laptops, secure areas, human trafficking, all those kinds of issues. Yeah, and we did look actually over time, would the pattern of the blood vessels change? Because blood vessels, I guess, come and go. they're not there for life at least, but the fingerprint is. In fact, the fingerprint is set down in the 19th week in the womb, and the pattern stays the same. It gets bigger, but the actual pattern stays the same for life, unless you burn it or somehow wear it off. Burn it as Al Capone famously tried to do. But you will see that there are different blood vessels here 30 days later. The fingerprint looks the same, but actually the pattern of the blood vessels stays the same. And that's logical because they have to supply these bridges in any case, and they have to be blood vessels within 64 microns of those living cells, and the living cells are bumping up like that on the surface. 64, 65 microns is a very, very short distance, right? It's about 1/20th of a millimeter. Okay, so those are the kinds of things that we're doing in our lab. We've got as far as OCT so far, and I said that with OCT, we're using ballistic light to go straight in and come straight back. But you can imagine that, you know, if there are lots of obstacles on your way going in or coming back from the tissue, at some point the light just can't go in and come straight back. It must be bounced around. And that turns out to be about 1 millimeter. So about 1 in 10 billion photons makes it 1 millimeter into the skin, 1 millimeter back, or 2 millimeters into a mouse brain and 2 millimeters back, but 1 in 10 billion. And that turns out to be about as far as we can go with the instrumentation we have. It means that our instrumentation has to have a signal to noise ratio of better than 100 dB, which is very, very challenging. So to see deeper, we have to use photons that are bounced around, and we're going to use photoacoustics to do that. There are a number of other ways. Diffuse optics is a more general field. When people talk about diffuse optical tomography, they mean just light. So light going in and having lots of detectors picking up the light. They try to do this in the brain, in the breast, and other areas. And you can do it, but the resolution is maybe half a centimeter, maybe 5 millimeters, or maybe even a centimeter in some cases. So here we get resolution which is much better than that. Again, we're on my forearm, looking at the wrist, and you can see some of the blood vessels there. And you see the blood vessels because the light is absorbed very strongly by the blood. So I said that we're going to pick this up using an ultrasound scanner. So we need to generate an ultrasound wave with light. So how do we do that? We do it by producing a very short pulse. Right? Not as short as your attosecond pulses in the extreme light facility here in Szeged, but short nonetheless, about 5 nanoseconds. So a nanosecond is 1 billion times shorter than a second. Very short pulse. The pulse of light goes into the tissue. You pick a wavelength that will be absorbed by the thing you want to see. So if you want to see melanoma, you pick a wavelength that will be absorbed by that. If you want to see oxygenated blood, you pick a wavelength that will be absorbed by oxygenated blood. Deoxygenated blood, the same thing. You put your pulse of light in. It vibrates. Let's say the oxygenated blood, right? It's the right wavelength. So the oxygenated blood expands like that very quickly. So mechanically, there is no time for the heat to dissipate. If you put in a very long pulse or a continuous wave, the heat would just dissipate out around the place. But if you put in a short pulse, it'll vibrate everything. So you get every frequency coming back. And you can choose an ultrasound of whatever frequency you want to look at it. So if you want a very high resolution, use a high frequency ultrasound. You won't see very deep, but you can use a high frequency ultrasound. If you want a something quite deep, you might use a clinical ultrasound system that's about 5 megahertz. Right? In that case, you get half a millimeter resolution or something like that. If you use 40 megahertz, you might get 100 micron resolution, a tenth of a millimeter resolution. So you can pick out the blood vessels if you put in the right wavelength of light for that. In this case, because we wanted to go quite deep, we chose 860 nanometers. Not the best, the most absorbing, absorbed wavelength for blood, but gets deeper into the tissue without being scattered around too much, and still produces quite a good contrast compared to the background skin. Okay, and just to illustrate this relationship between depth and resolution, if you want to see deep, use a low frequency scanner. 15 megahertz is actually already high on a clinical ultrasound scale, high frequency. You can get reasonably good resolution with that, but notice that as you go to these higher frequencies, you get better resolution. You actually see two vessels where they might look like one on that low resolution thing. Okay? And that is also an important point. It's not really about having the fastest scanner or the brightest scanner or the highest resolution scanner. It's about what do you see that informs the clinician that would change their decision. Right? If it wouldn't change their clinical decision, would you produce a prettier image? That is not going to be commercially viable, and it's not going to have any impact on the clinic. Right? It's, what is important is that you give information that changes the decision. So if the resolution is going from 15 megahertz to 40 megahertz, you actually see that there's a vein and an artery, and if that happens to be important for a clinical decision, then that's a winner. But if it isn't, if it's not going to change the clinician's decision, then it's just a nice academic publication. See the difference? Okay, that was published, but not in that journal. So, anyway. We can use different wavelengths of light, but we get similar images. What does this look like? Well, the scanner looks very much like an ultrasound scanner, except it's got an extra lead going into it, delivering the light. Okay, and the light is delivered into the tissue at an angle like this. Typically, we will have a 5 nanosecond pulse, which has about 45 millijoules of energy in each pulse. It's important that every wavelength has the same amount of energy if you want to compare them, or you need to balance that when you reproduce the image. And we repeat the pulse 20 times per second, 20 hertz. In the case of this device, we can have any wavelength from 680 up to 970 nanometers, plus the driving laser, which is 1064, the doubled laser, which is 532, and you might say, well, how is 532 double 1064? It's, you're doubling the frequency, so you're halving the wavelength of the light. And because we were interested in things like brown fat, we also bought this laser that goes from 1200 to 2000 nanometers. And it hasn't worked out so far, but we are hoping to be able to see things like different types of fat in plaques in the carotid artery. So, because you use the ultrasound to detect both the photoacoustic and the ultrasound image, they're both automatically co-registered. They're coming from the same signal, so you don't need to somehow stitch them together, which is an important thing. So here's how it works. You're putting in a signal. This one happens to work in four quadrants, the 256 transducers on the ultrasound array are split into four. It's kind of a detail. Importantly, the light is coming in two sheets from the side and has a pseudo focus. It's sort of about 7 millimeters from the edge of the transducer. In this particular case, we get a resolution of 140 microns. That's what we actually measured. We were promised 100 microns. So the detail. But that's the real value of what you get. You still need to use an ultrasound gel because you need to couple the mechanical vibration from the tissue into the ultrasound probe. You know how they put you squeeze some transparent gel onto your surface. Most of you, I presume, have seen or know how fecal scan is done. So it's the same kind of thing. And in the same way as OCT, you get this A scan, which is a graph basically of the intensity, the depth, just one line into the tissue. If you scan along in this direction, you get what is known as a B scan. Same terminology as ultrasound and OCT. And if you scan in the other third direction, you get a 3D scan of the tissue. So now you have a 3D picture. OCT is used for other things. We've used it for intracoronary scanning. And the advantage there is that we can see not just the shape of the vessel, but we can see what's below the surface. So that first millimeter below the surface, we can see if there's some plaque, if there's a stenosis there. So here you're basically cutting, I think, the femoral popliteal vessel and then pushing the catheter up, finding your way to the coronary artery. And then you expand the balloon and then you pull it backwards 50 millimeters while scanning around and around with the fiber optic thing, looking at the wall. And you can produce this kind of image of what's going on inside the coronary artery. So you can see where the stenosis is. You can see what kind of plaque is there based on the grains, the sizes. You're guided by that image you see in A there, which is a kind of fluoroscopy image. It's X-ray, basically a live X-ray where you've injected fluorescent a radio-opaque dye, which is, something like iodine, so it blocks the X-rays, and so you can see where your catheter has got to and how to get to your coronary artery. Before you had that, people used to try and find this by themselves, which is quite a journey. One of the things, of course, we were interested in is, well, can we see little blood vessels in the wall of the coronary artery, and they would tell us that there is something growing in the vasa vasorum, and this would tell us if that is a vulnerable plaque or not a vulnerable plaque. We've been able to do that in a kind of a model, but never really been able to see them in vivo yet, so that's quite a challenge. But we had to develop some new algorithms in order to do that. I've said a lot about OCT today, and I think you might wonder, well, why do I spend so much time talking about OCT? Partly, yes, we do spend a lot of time working on OCT. We've invested a lot of time and effort and money in it. But maybe more importantly, from your point of view, it is the fastest growing imaging modality in the history of medicine. Right? And there have been a lot of very interesting imaging modalities in medicine. I can update these numbers. Eric Swanson, who produced these numbers, told me last year that it's already saved $30 billion in healthcare costs in the United States alone up until 2018. Or for the record, since we never get up to 2018, people at that time had bought, well, by 2017, had already bought $6 billion worth of OCT equipment. Most of that is for looking at diseases of the eye, a big chunk of it now, expanding chunk of it, probably much more than 20%, is looking inside the heart. A large chunk of it is also now in dermatology, and there are many other applications of it. I just want to say a few words before I finish about how we see deeper into tissue and some of the developments you may have heard. Many people have heard of something called clarity. Clarity is a way of is a way of clearing tissues, sometimes whole animals, so that you can see deeper into them. So we want to be able to see what's going on deeper in tissue, deeper inside a small animal, so that we can assess whether our drugs are getting to the proper site, how they're working, how that happens over time. Much more difficult to do this in vivo, in living animals, and especially humans, but this again is the human forearm, not actually mine, one of my students. You can see on the left an OCT image where we've done this CMOCT algorithm to pick out where the blood vessels are. And on the right, we can see an image after what we call optical clearing. This method of optical clearing is where we put fructose. Could have been glucose, or it could have been glycerol. It turns out the fructose gets into the tissue more easily and seems to stay there a little bit longer, so we can get better images. And also is, as far as we know, quite harmless. So we can see more vessels, we can see deeper after clearing.